resources as well as federal resources, the conversations to move forward will be key. Equitable access to the internet should be a given, and it's not. Now is the time to make concrete plans to ensure that this is a reality for all of our young people. There's a variety of places where we can look to help address some of these concerns. For example, in the American Rescue Plan, there's a $7 billion there's $7 billion available to assist schools and libraries to bridge the homework gap during the pandemic. So we can and must look to long-term systemic investment to ensure that our students have the tools and resources they need to thrive. Thank you for the opportunity to join this important hearing today. I've attached several of these articles and studies for your reference, and I look forward to answering any questions that you may have. Thank you again for your time.
Thank you, Hillary.
Thank you, Rep. Isaacson.
And stay with us. We're going to go to Lawrence Jones and then Dr. Robin Cooper. So, Mr. Jones?
Thank you. Good morning, everyone. I'd first like to say thank you to Chairman Bizarro and to Representative Harris and all of the members of the Democratic Policy Committee. My name is Lawrence Jones. I am one of the founders and the chief executive officer of the Richard Allen Preparatory Charter School. We're a middle charter school located in Southwest Philadelphia. I also serve as the vice president of the Pennsylvania Coalition of Public Charter Schools and a founding member of the African American Coalition of Charter Schools. I'm here today mostly in my capacity as a school leader and school operator, and appreciate this opportunity to speak on what is a very important issue to students that I serve and really to our entire Commonwealth and our entire nation. I think before going on, while this may not be the specific focus of this hearing nor of my testimony, I think it has to be said and must continue to be said that the reasons we see these discrepancies in resources is tied to abject and generational poverty. And that poverty is often the result of systemic biases and policies that are existing in multiple facets of our communities, not just in education, but it is certainly found there. And we will not be able to eradicate the digital divide completely until we seek out and eradicate each and every one of those biased policies and make them right. And that has to be the mission that we all undertake in a partnership and collaborative way. But today we are here with more of a focus on the digital divide. And it's always been there, but I think last March 13th, when schools closed, it became so much more important to each and every one of us. At our school, we felt like we were being proactive because on March 13th, we took an emergency day off to prepare for what we thought would be a very short-term time away from school in the event that a closure did happen. We thought getting 2 weeks of packets together would make sense. We were wrong. We quickly had to pivot into providing Chromebooks and doing digital learning. Now, we didn't have enough Chromebooks, and luckily we were able, through philanthropic support, to get Chromebooks. And the previous speaker alluded to the fact that before we could even start planning, before we could talk about our students' academic well-being or social-emotional well-being, the hard work of simply finding devices was placed upon school leaders and educators. It was not a comfortable position to be in. It wasn't comfortable for us, and it certainly wasn't comfortable for our families, because once again, it shined a light on the fact of the things that they were unable to provide in many ways for their children. We provided Chromebooks for students, but let me be clear, it was not optimal. We had students who had to share Chromebooks. We had students that maybe had one device in the home, but also found time to do their work on a mobile device or a cell phone. This is not how online learning was designed to be done. And so many of our students started off a difficult situation with an additional deficit. But we all got through it. And then we came into the fall, and with some semblance of knowing that this was coming, we were able to get more devices. But here's what everyone has to keep in mind. simply getting one device for a student does not solve the digital divide. Even if we were to get every student with a device and every student with appropriate internet access, the technological divide may be addressed, but there are also cultural and historic divides. For example, when students look at technology as a tool that is used every day, like a pen or a pencil, it's different. And if you don't have that tool available to you in your household, if you're not used to that, that also creates a barrier, that also creates a divide that needs to be bridged. We weren't able to see every student having a device. Even when we did get them, students had difficulty and parents had difficulty adapting to the software and adapting to the different platforms. And so once again, if you are a student or you are in a position where this was second nature to you, it's something that is difficult. And now I'm not trying to be funny and I'm not trying to be sarcastic, but I recently started a doctoral program. And I can assure you that in this online program, when I started doing my assignments, it took me about a week and a half to 2 weeks to really get comfortable. Let me not lie. It took me 2 weeks to begin to get comfortable with that process. So now we have students who were shifted into the process and parents who were also shifted into that process. So as we move forward, looking at the impact of the digital divide on the academic productivity of students, those types of cultural and realistic and basic problems have to be addressed as well. We also need to take a look at what is happening with our teachers. Many people believe that when we shifted to virtual learning, all you had to do was make your class look just like your normal class, but online. That is not the case. Providing engaging, thoughtful, and lessons that are meaningful to students in an online modality is not like doing it in a classroom. Developing relationships with students is not the same when you're doing it virtually. And for parents wanting to support their children, that is not the same as well. So before I wrap up, I think it is very important that we look at a few things that we may want to do as we move forward that could help things out. One of the things that we've discovered is that we have to get out of the mindset of looking at a one-to-one device community. If students have a device in school, even when we are 100% back in school, that is not enough. If a child cannot take a device home and have access to the internet or at least access to that material at home, then a one-to-one device in school is useless. So we are figuring out how we're going to be able to fund a two-to-one program, making sure that the educational software and other programs that students engage with can be accessed if they don't have the internet. So what do I mean? If a student only can save things to the cloud and they take their device home and their internet is shaky, then they're not going to be able to access their educational content. If we invest in devices that will allow them to save things to flash, if we invest in devices that will allow them to save to a hard drive, that will help them. And finally, we have to be creative in ways like opening up various community-based organizations, YMCAs, Boys and Girls Clubs. Some districts have even looked at putting Wi-Fi on buses so that students have as many opportunities to gain access to online educational services as possible. This is not just about wires and devices and internet. This digital divide is in many ways a cultural divide. It is a divide that is, if we do not close it, will result in students losing out on educational opportunities, employment opportunities, and most importantly, the opportunity to engage in a healthy, productive, and happy lifestyle. I thank you very much. I ask that we all can look to be collaborative in how we solve these problems, and once again, how we root down to making sure that equity goes to all of our students. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. And next, we are going to have Dr. Robin Cooper from the Philadelphia Principals Union. Robin? Dr. Cooper? There you
go. Good morning, too.
Good morning. Thank you.
Good morning to the PA House Democratic Policy Committee. I'm Dr. Robin Cooper, proud president of Teamsters Local 502. The main focus of today's leadership should be on eliminating barriers that impact both student and teachers and instructional outcomes. These are the barriers that maintain and increase the divide between the rich and the poor in this country. For far too long, marginalized communities, including people of color, low-income individuals, English language learners, people with disabilities, and populations experiencing homelessness are among those students who are most likely to lack access to high-speed internet. The impact of the digital divide during the pandemic on these students has been significant and continues to worsen. There is and has always been a cry for a proper funding formula as it relates to the students in the Philadelphia School District, a district that everyone recognizes as being woefully underfunded. For years, educators in the city of Philadelphia have had to work within the confines of limited budgets, huge overheads, and political decisions which have had little to do with educating our young leaders of tomorrow. Instead of a focus on teaching and learning, the focus for the last several years has been on removing lead, mold, and asbestos and trying to figure out how to keep our children safe in schools that should be some of the safest havens in the city. These environmental hazards were coupled with the pandemic of the century that crippled a nation and sent millions of children home to learn remotely without access to quality resources that in this day and age should be universally available to all students, regardless of schools, school districts, and/or zip codes. A Pew Research report concluded that 35% of students in our nation lack access to broadband. The report stated that the quality of remote learning is decided by several factors: access to quality, reliable internet, quality of learning and of teaching, home support, and level of engagement. But in addition, let's not forget that during the pandemic, there is an increase in risk factors of the struggle for healthcare, access to nutrition, and other basic needs in our low-income communities. We all know that one of the most important factors in ensuring student success is guaranteeing that every student has access to quality and reliable internet. We see this as a part of our fight for racial justice, equity, and inclusion in Philadelphia. Students whose families are struggling at this time should have equal access to quality education. They should not be excluded because of economic reasons. We recoiled in horror as our students' parents were told to drive to their schools or the district headquarters parking lots to sit in the parking lots to access the district's Wi-Fi in order for them to assist in helping their children to complete assignments. Yes, you heard me correctly. Parents were to park their cars in parking lots for 4 to 6 hours a day, every day, to engage in remote learning. We watched in disbelief as Comcast gave limited bandwidth to needy children, not the broadband access necessary for appropriate remote instruction. During the summer of 2020, Teamsters Local 502, CASA, we rallied at Comcast headquarters requesting that the wealthy conglomerate give back to the various community neighborhoods whose generational families have assisted over the last three decades in building the dynasty into what it is today. We rallied and asked for, and what should have been a given for our inner city students, equal access to high quality, high speed internet. Not being afforded broadband access like their suburban counterparts injured many of our students before the pandemic and paralyzed many more once schools closed their doors and retreated into the world of remote learning. Although Comcast pulled through for our district families, it came a little too late as some of our students still were not able to access the internet due to built-in structural elements, limited technology support, and/or lack of awareness of school and community resources. As a result, some of our students are going back to school with poor communication skills, poor social skills, and limited ability to research needed information to advance in a technologically changing society. The impact of the digital divide easily widened during the pandemic, and now we have to have a strategic plan in place to ensure that technology is given the priority that it deserves in our city. So what have we learned? We've learned that when the pandemic happened, there was no plan for sustainable professional development opportunities. Therefore, teachers, administrators, CASA, we train principals, and principals in alignment with their teachers, we worked together and we were self-taught during the pandemic of how to teach remotely. That should have been something that was a given, where there was somewhere where people could go to access high quality professional development. We have to make certain that our teachers are trained, our administrators are trained, and that we are trained as a city so we can narrow the divide. Our administrators came up with wonderful programs like Teens, Tweens, and Quarantines, just to really touch on the social emotional health. We need these kind of programs so we can stay in touch with our students who are away from us and we don't know what's going on. So we know about the digital divide. We know that there is a gap between the haves and the have-nots. And we want to make sure that we fully recognize that funding is needed. So we are asking the PA House of Representatives, who has been an incredible source of financial assistance to Philadelphia schools for so many years, we are asking for a dedicated funding stream to address the technological inequities in the School District of Philadelphia. Teamsters Local 502, CASA, is calling on the PA House of Representatives to bring about true equity through connectivity to all of Philadelphia students, especially during this ongoing COVID-19 crisis. Thank you. I am Dr. Robin Cooper, president of Teamsters Local 502.
Thank you so much to all of you for your testimony. Being a representative from Philadelphia County, I am well aware of the gap we have with regard to education funding and the poverty level that strikes our city as one of the poorest large cities in the nation. A quick question I have real quick is for you, Hillary. You talked about the $7 billion that is gonna be there to assist with the quote unquote homework gap.
Yes.
Is that eligible to be used to help make investments in technology? I mean, as we all know, I have two teenagers and Lord knows they run circles around me on technology, and we need to make sure that every child has access to be able to do that, because that is the future of our society. Is any of that money allowed to be used for that?
Yes. So it's related to schools and libraries, and I believe Rep. Isaacson, I'll make sure one of the links I included there has the specifics of how it can be used, and the FCC has to issue regulations specifically regarding its use. So that has to take place by May, I believe, if my memory serves. I believe the recommendations from the FCC have to take place. But yes, it can work towards laptop computers. It can work towards connectivity. So yeah, it's definitely a good component of the package that we want to make sure we pay attention to.
Okay, then it's our job to make sure PDE knows that too.
Yes. So,
all right, thank you. Chairman Long has a question.
Thank you all. And kind of picking up on the last question, and I realize that we're waiting to hear for more guidance from the federal government. But in the meantime, what do you believe? I mean, these clearly are one-time funds at this point. And I don't know if they are in addition to or different from the funds that individual school districts are receiving. But where do you believe those funds are best deployed to address these issues? How would you spend it?
Rep. Longetti, if I could take a quick crack at that. I appreciate the question. We are, as PFT, in the process of surveying our membership as well as the community. We have a survey that we've issued with our Fund Our Facilities Coalition to identify key priorities in spending. I think that you heard Dr. Cooper reference something that we have long been fighting for, which are the facilities conditions, the lead, asbestos, mold. I think that so far our initial results of our survey are showing that that is a key priority because we believe that students, we have sort of, you know, the belief that students should be able to go into schools and not get poisoned. And that's a very, very, very baseline belief that shouldn't be controversial and yet somehow still is. So we believe that that will be one of the most impactful ways that the funding can be spent. We certainly think that technology access and other supports for our students are going to be crucial. So we'll have a lot more to say about how this funding should be spent once we really have been able to gauge the community response as well as our membership response. But certainly school facilities is going to be a key component since it is one-time funding and that will have a very, very long-lasting effect.
Do any of the others want to comment?
Sure. I just would piggyback on that and add two things. When we look at school facilities, there's also going to be additional school infrastructure that's needed. As we started to do more of the virtual instruction, and you know, again, many people believe that pandemics will happen and there will be other times where we will be in hybrid and virtual. One of the things that we saw is also in school buildings, our internet capacity was stretched. We had students that we identified were unable because of various home situations to engage. We brought those students into the building, and as soon as you had those students in combination with a few staff members on a Zoom, the internet reached its limits. So if we're going to continue to do these things, which we are going to have to, there's going to be buildings, infrastructure and other technology needs, not just for the students, but for home. And also, professional development is going to be key. Our staff members, our administrators are going to have to know how to be able to not only provide virtual instruction, but how do you pivot back and forth? One of the reports that have come from a lot of the hybrid classes have been that the students who are physically in a building sometimes feel as if they're not being paid attention to because the students who are virtual get more. How do we figure out and how do our teachers get trained on how best to provide this education? And I would say this is one of the things where the various stakeholders can work together and put some of our sector and political issues aside, and this is where we can look at things like cyber charter schools and work together and say, hey, let's figure out how to all do this.
Just piggybacking on what my esteemed colleagues have said, I definitely think that you have to put money into these resources, especially by way of some systematic trainings. There has to be trainings across the state, across the city, just to make certain that people, I'm certain in every school, folks were self-trained. And, you know, we are a comprehensive city. Philadelphia is a comprehensive city. Pennsylvania is one of the premier states. And yet, in the pandemic, in the beginning parts, we were self-taught. But then when we came back, like in September, we were still self-taught, self-learning, self-everything. At some point, we have to get a group of experts that really understand, you know, technology so teachers can be trained, administrators can be trained, leaders across the state can be trained so we can give children what they need. So how do you teach children virtually and in class at the same time? Because right now it's a hodgepodge approach because teachers are just doing the very best that they can, but yet we still want to hold them accountable for testing and we still want to, you know, to go in and observe them when it is going to not look so well when you go in to observe because there has not been any professional training to assist them. It's sort of catch as catch can. And I think we can do better just as a city and state.
Just one more point. As the state looks to spend dollars from the American Rescue Plan that it's been allocated, I believe, you know, in the last year we had a sort of like a pilot program where we allocated about $5 million to help with grants to create or establish connectivity out in the community. You know, obviously there are issues of connectivity in lots of parts of Pennsylvania. Does it make sense to use that existing program infrastructure and pour dollars into that now that we've got a lot more money than $5 million to help, you know, establish connectivity in the community? Does that make sense to you?
I'll defer.
All right, nobody's biting on that one, so I'll just leave that laying out there as a thought. Thank you.
And thank you, Representative Longetti. Representative Cephas, for question.
Thank you, and I'll be quick given the time that we have, but I do want to honestly thank all three of you for just representing the experience in Philadelphia from, you know, the teachers union, from the principals union, and from our charter school group. I think it's important to just gather different perspectives as we move forward, because you are all on the front line with our students. You're on the front line in the buildings, and essentially we work for you. So you telling us what we need to do as we move forward, or at least what we need to think about, is going to be critical at this time. So my question is, I don't necessarily have a question, but more of a statement. We have some significant financial opportunities coming down the pike that's just once in a lifetime. So that not just includes the American Rescue Plan, but those dollars, but also the dollars that were forced for us to find to support that digital divide grant that Chairman Longetti just spoke about. But we also have the federal government talking about doing a robust infrastructure package. And, you know, I understand normally it's about roads and bridges, but we need to ensure that we're incorporating this infrastructure of our school building. So I, you know, just would love for, as you're doing your surveying, as you're having conversations with your stakeholder groups, to really think about how do we strategize and align our strategies as it relates to these different buckets coming down the pike. And I think the last piece, God willing, we get this across the line, but the governor's proposal to allow for RCAP to be used as another infrastructure opportunity. And to the point that many of my colleagues stated, these are going to be one-time spending opportunities. So how do we use this moment in time as an opportunity to, you know, rebuild and create an education system that really is founded in equity? And I think, you know, we're going to need your input, you know, beyond this hearing, but, you know, coming up with a hardcore set of recommendations as it relates to each and every bucket that we might have an opportunity to spend. So I just would say think big, and, you know, hopefully we will be able to, you know, address and accommodate all of the challenges that we're experiencing today. So again, I just want to thank you for your testimony, and I look forward to us, you know, working moving forward. Thank you, Chairman.
Thank you, Representative. And final question. Then he can transition into the next panel, Representative Schreier.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. First and foremost, for those of you who don't know, I actually started my professional career after college as a school teacher in West Philly. I was part of a program called Teach Philadelphia. And whereas I ended up not teaching too long because of some family issues, it was a remarkable and eye-opening and wonderful experience that gave me a little bit of perspective going in. So thank you all for your testimony. Thank you all for your incredible work for kids in our Commonwealth. And I think in a moment you're going to hear that the experiences that students in Philadelphia and teachers and professionals in the industry in Philadelphia are experiencing is very similar to those in the school district I represent, the Allentown School District. Also, as part of panel two, is a student from Greene County, way in the southwest corner of the Commonwealth of Pennsylvania. Real quick, before I introduce the second panel, I just wanted to comment, Chairman Longetti, you asked about that digital divide grant program. And whereas I certainly support the objectives of that grant program, PDE did an absolutely abhorrent job of distributing those funds out, so far as I can tell. They had made promises about how much certain school districts were receiving, only to have that dollar figure be walked back dramatically. And in the case of my school district, the Allentown School District, they were told they were getting $850,000 from a grant that maxed out at, I think, $250,000, and then ASD got not a nickel. So that the concept was great. PDE's execution of that was just an abject failure, one of a handful of failures that we saw during this early days of the pandemic, and really put a lot of academically struggling kids in a bad situation. I'm not shy. I've had this conversation with past secretaries of PDE, as well as the governor's executive team. So this isn't something that I've been shy about. With that said, talking about that very issue, are two professionals from the Allentown School District that I'm going to introduce one at a time, and then one that my friend and colleague, Representative Snyder, will be introducing at the end of this panel. The first person I'd like to introduce is Dr. Lucretia Brown. Dr. Brown is the Deputy Superintendent of our school district for Equity, Accountability, and School Improvement. Just a quick note before Dr. Brown and Principal Bodner come on, just a personal note, my children are students in the Allentown School District, so this is not only a professional concern of mine, but very much a personal concern. So Dr. Brown, interested in hearing your thoughts.
Thank you, Representative Schweier. Thank you, Chairman Bizarro and other distinguished members of the committee for the opportunity to speak today. Just as you mentioned, Representative Schweier, our experience wasn't too different at the onset of the pandemic than what was experienced in the city of Philadelphia. I'll begin with a quote just to reiterate some of the civil rights issues that have been acclimated for us today or highlighted for us today. Before passing, U.S. Congressman John Lewis mentioned that access to the internet was the civil rights issue of the 21st century. And we would argue that that experience was further legitimized by school districts such as Philadelphia and the Allentown School District, where our educators, our families, and our students really experienced a more acute sort of learning environment based on the pandemic. Specifically, COVID-19, it highlighted a lot of those factors such as race, color, privilege, and poverty all at the same time. And we scrambled to really support our students during that crisis time. We closed our doors on March 12th upon hearing about our initial COVID-19 exposure in our district. And even at that time, while the state still watched the virus spread throughout other cities, we knew that being the first district to close, we had to support our students and our families immediately. We had administrators come in that night, that next day, over the weekend to make copies where we couldn't send out copies to local copying places. And we printed and we pushed out to our buildings to try to get our learning packets out to our families immediately. While the virus spread and we began to see how this was unfolding in our nation, we knew that we had to figure out a way to get the limited devices that we had on hand into the hands of our families. And so we came up with a rule, one device per household where we could. And we also knew that we couldn't really define what the digital divide meant or how we could quantify that in our district. So we pushed out a technology survey. And out of the over 16,000 students that we had in our district, about 13,000 were able to complete the survey. So off the top, we concluded, whether right or wrong, that at least 3,000 couldn't even get access to the internet or any device to complete the survey. Out of those 13,000, we found that 10,000 students did not have access to high-speed internet. We also found that 6,500 of those 13,000 that responded did not have a device, and another 2,000 students utilized their smartphone for access to any of the learning or digital materials we were posting on our website. And so that helped us sort of give some sort of shape to our story and our harsh reality. So we set out and we had a four-prong approach that really emerged organically. First, internally, we had to reallocate funding. That meant that dollars that we received from the federal government for supplemental supports in our education, All of our middle schools are identified as low performing, the bottom 5% in the Commonwealth, and all of our high schools have a school improvement designation. So we had to take dollars that were allocated to support or reduce the achievement gap, to address proficiency, and reallocate them, take them away from their needed identity, and put them into the purchasing of technology. So there, that just exacerbated a number of the inequities in our district alone. From reallocation of dollars, we're fortunate enough to be in a city where our communities rallied around, our community agencies rallied around us and worked to support our students as well. Flagship organizations like the United Way, Communities and Schools, even municipal organizations such as our Lehigh Valley Planning Commission were able to take data from our households and arrange them according to the zip codes, where we were able to rank our most impoverished zip codes so that we could allocate our scarce resources of devices based on zip code, because we didn't have enough and we needed to be really intentional about where we were pushing out our devices. We had grassroots organizations such as UNIDOS and the Ortiz Art Foundation. We had philanthropic organizations such as the Century Fund and the Allentown School District Foundation, all of which helped us to acquire or made donations of devices, which included Chromebooks and Wi-Fi hotspots, to push them into the homes of our students. Once we were able to get those two strategies going, we had a third strategy that emerged organically. Special thanks to our local legislators, Representative Schweier and his colleagues, that sponsored and supported the district for a grant from the Department of Community and Economic Development. The entire allocation was used to purchase Wi-Fi hotspots and continue to push those out during this global pandemic. So it wasn't like other districts where we could have folks come up and get your hotspot and your device, but it was piecemealed and incremental and thereby had a negative impact on the learning environment that we were able to support in the homes of our students. As I continue, our fourth and final sort of approach that we piecemealed, and again, it developed organically, came from the Project 10 Million from T-Mobile. We were able to apply for the grant. Our team very quickly assembled and compiled all of the student demographic data required to support the application, where we were awarded approximately 2,000 Wi-Fi hotspots, which again was another incremental sort of support that we just recently received at the beginning of this year to provide another 2,000 students with access to high-speed internet. So in closing, I'll say that it's the community effort, the community anchoring organizations that really supported our students, our local legislators, and the efforts of our principals and teachers, which you'll hear an example next from one of our highest poverty elementary schools in the district. As we move forward, we're hopeful that there'll be some legislation or support for municipalities and school districts specifically, as we have it confirmed for us that a device and access to the internet are the new textbook, pen, and pencil. We cannot support 21st literacy and innovation without supporting equitable access to a device or two, as we've heard from our colleague in Philadelphia, and the internet as well. And again, the professional development and the support for our families to undergird their internet literacy, if you will all combined to support our family, our students, and their teaching and learning environment that we know is forever changed. We will not return to just the traditional sit-in classroom. We must be prepared to oscillate between face-to-face learning, hybrid learning, and true virtual remote learning. So I'll close and hope that the ASD story certainly supports the level of advocacy that we're discussing here today. And thank you again, Representative Schweier and other members of the committee, for the opportunity to tell the ASD story. So thank you.
Absolutely, and thank you for all of your efforts and all of your help for our kids. Moving on, because we're trying to be mindful of the time, I'd like to introduce Rebecca Bodner. Rebecca is principal of Central Elementary School, which is one of our poorest elementary schools located in Center City, Allentown.
Thank you, Representative Schweier. I also want to thank Mr. Chairman and members of the subcommittee. My name is Rebecca Bodner. I'm principal at Central Elementary School in the Allentown School District. I appreciate the opportunity to speak with you today on behalf of administrators and school officials who have experienced the digital divide and its effects on our students. I also want to say hello to Mr. Facinetto's fifth grade social studies class, who's learning about civics and the government, and they're watching us live today. Central is located in the heart of Allentown, and we are home to 723 students in grades kindergarten through fifth. Our demographics are like most other surrounding elementary schools, with about 80% Hispanic students and about 15% Black or African American students. Our poverty rating at Central is, however, one of the highest in the district. I want you to imagine, it's Wednesday, March 11th, and I'm reviewing our plans for our in-service day on Friday the 13th. The news just broke about schools shutting down due to COVID, and students and staff will not be returning to school until further notice. A week or so later, we are told that Allentown School District students and staff are going to pivot to online learning, which meant that we had to move mountains to make this happen. This is when I truly realized firsthand the digital divide. Surrounding school districts like Parkland and East Penn seamlessly transitioned within 1 week, and other school districts like Bethlehem and Easton were fully online within 2 weeks. How could we be on different playing fields when we are all essentially from the same block? Central had roughly 200 devices to share among my 700 students. We had no idea we were going to get another 500 devices, and even if I did have them, how would I get them in the hands of all of the students and families that needed them? I want to rewind for a moment and go back to pre-pandemic. One-to-one technology has always been a goal of ours, and over the years, I was able to purchase roughly 50 devices a year, but as soon as I had more in the building, the older ones were being phased out or could not keep up with the demands of the online programs we were using. Typically, we had about 10% of our students accessing online programs at home. Majority of their work was done in school, and if something needed to be completed at home, our teachers ensured it did not require technology or internet access. Of course, there was a local library, but that is not a reasonable ask of 700 students. We were, however, able to provide one device per household, like Dr. Brown had mentioned, to our families. While neighboring schools were fully up and running with virtual instruction and did not skip a beat with covering grade level standards. We had, on average at Central, only 25% of our students logging on daily in the spring to participate in online lessons and instruction. Thankfully, Allentown School District was able to secure funding and devices to help us get at least one device in each household last spring. We were able to give out 391 devices in over 200 hotspots. Through the district's work all summer, we were able to give out 680 devices in over 400 hotspots this fall. That's 94% of my building needed a device to successfully do their schoolwork. Internet access is not a luxury. We need to do a better job at leveraging internet companies to ensure internet access is a viable option for all families, regardless of their zip code. I would like to recommend and propose a tax credit, which would consider multiple criteria. Does the child attend a Title I designated school? Is the child residing in a shelter, or are they currently displaced? And what is the household income, and does it fall on or below the poverty line? Additionally, we need to talk to and ask our internet providers to consider providing a sliding scale access. There seems to be no cap on the monthly charges and increases that we all witness firsthand on internet service. The cost of internet services in the Lehigh Valley start from $29.99 a month for only 10 megabits a second, which is a very minimal service and not what our students need to have access to complete their schoolwork. Why couldn't our service providers work with our families so have students in schools to do their part to ensure they are helping to pave the way for our future leaders? I would like to, again, thank everyone for the opportunity to speak and truly hope that we can have some things in place to do a better job at helping all of our students have access to high-speed internet and the devices that they need to complete their work online. Thank you.
Thank you, Principal Blattner. I appreciate your perspective. I'd like to turn the hearing over at this point in time to Representative Pam Snyder from Greene County.
Thank you, Representative. It is a real honor for me to have Taylor Burnfield with us. Taylor is a junior at Jefferson Morgan High School. She's a member of the National Honor Society, the Foreign Language Club, and the Envirothon team. My husband and I are members of the local Lions Club here in the Jefferson Morgan School District. And last fall, Taylor attended the Lions Club meeting because she is also a member of the Leo Club. And after the meeting was over, she came up to me and she said, Representative Snyder, can you please help me? I cannot do my schoolwork because I cannot access the internet. I have to either drive to my grandmother's driveway. She told me the whole story. And, you know, for me, everyone knows this has been a drum I've been beating for quite a few years. And the testimony today is so enlightening. But for me to have to look at this young lady in the eyes and say, I'm trying. But deep in my heart, I know I probably will not be able to accomplish that goal for Taylor before she graduates from high school, because this is such a trying issue. So I am so grateful today that we are going to be able to hear a perspective from a student. So Taylor, please tell us your story.
Thank you, Pam. It's an honor to be speaking in front of you all today. And first, I just want to set the scene of where I live and my situation. So a half a mile to the right of my house, there is a neighbor of mine who has 4 bars of LTE cellular data and Atlantic broadband internet. And 500 yards to the left of my house, on top of a hill, there is another neighbor of mine who has 3 bars of LTE data and Windstream. But me, I am in the middle, and I have 3 bars of 3G data, and I have no internet whatsoever. After calling weekly for about a year and a half now, not even a single worker has showed up to my house from the internet companies to try and take a look at our situation to see if it's even possible for us to get internet. So how does this affect my schoolwork? I just want to start off by saying that COVID didn't create this problem. It highlighted it. I have been dealing with the struggles of not having internet since 6th grade when my teacher asked me to type an essay, and I couldn't because I didn't have internet and I wasn't aware of doing things on a phone because I didn't have a phone yet. So like I said, COVID didn't create this problem, it highlighted it. But I also think that it bolded it, it underlined it, it italicized it. So when my school got shut down and we all went remote in the middle of March, I really had to adapt quickly. To turn in pictures of my assignments, I would have to drive my family side-by-side to the top of our hill on which we live so my phone would get enough cellular data in order to turn my assignments in. At the beginning of the 2020-2021 school year, live sessions became mandatory, and again, I had to overcome this challenge. I went to my grandparents' house and sat on their porch and use their laptop and Wi-Fi so I could properly social distance from them since they had underlying health conditions while getting my work done and being able to attend my live sessions. I would spend from 10 a.m. to 2 p.m. or 8 a.m. to 3 p.m. on live sessions every day on their porch, depending on our current school situation, whether we were fully online or hybrid. I did that all the way up until October when the weather started getting bad, COVID cases were going up, and I couldn't go sit on my grandparents' porch anymore because it was freezing outside. So I had to get on live sessions from my house, and I'm not even sugarcoating this, it was an epic fail. Imagine FaceTiming somebody and it's saying poor connection the whole time, or trying to call someone and the whole time you're saying you're breaking up, you're breaking up. By January, my grades were going down and I knew I had to make a change. I started going to tutoring 2 times a week because I saw my calculus grade go from an A to a B. And I'm the type of student that I know that I can put in the work. If I see a B, I know I can do better. So I started going to these tutoring sessions, and by February, my school was going 4 days a week. And I don't want to say this problem went away or it was solved, because it obviously isn't. but it was exponentially easier to follow along since I didn't have to worry about the struggles that I faced with internet. And I want to make this, I want to make my statement relatable to everybody. And I know that during COVID and us all being in quarantine, we all heard of the Tiger King. And all of my friends were raving about Tiger King. And I remember downloading Netflix and getting the subscription. And I hooked my TV up to my phone. And I sat there and I watched my TV try to load Tiger King for 2 hours before I finally gave up. And I guess it wasn't meant to be. So hopefully one day I'll be able to watch Tiger King at my house. But until then, I can only be proud of the hardships and challenges that I have overcome to maintain my grades and be one of the top students of my class. Sadly, this story isn't the only story, and it's a story of thousands of kids across the state who don't have internet. And hopefully we can make a change, and my story will be one of the last stories of this particular hardship. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Taylor. That was outstanding. Pete, are you going to handle questions, or Ryan? How are we?
Happy to do so, but I believe Ryan was handling them before. But I will jump in and ask a very, very quick question, which is, you know, for Dr. Brown and Principal Bodner, just so you discussed a little bit about the language barriers that we have in the school district, and how difficult has it been for your teachers, for your educators, to be able to overcome that. I mean, obviously there's special education needs that are in every one of our school districts, but more unique to a district like Allentown. How has the language been a problem for us?
Yeah, and let me just say that out of our over 16,000 students, approximately 20% are student with IEPs, 20% are English learners, so that makes it about 3,500 students. We definitely had to have more intentional supports and interactions with that population during COVID. We have a dynamic director of ESOL and ESOL staff that literally provided sort of a one-stop shop for our families during COVID, so they could come in and receive resources, but also receive support in navigating this remote learning environment. We also took time to develop virtual sort of supports for our English learner parents and our parents of students with IEPs, so that they could have that sort of virtual simulation and even real-time support while their students were in small breakout rooms. So the challenges were much like the challenges we find in within in-person learning. However, again, as you would imagine, with the distance and the virtual component, it made it a bit more challenging. But just focusing on that group helped us to navigate it better, and allocating the different resources. We even set up a special support line and for our English learner students, as well as our families with special ed, so that they could access teachers outside of the normal workday during office hours and even in the evening to get that support. One of the challenges that we noticed that magnified itself was with our help desk. Initially, we hadn't thought about just basic help desk or repairing of our devices and how to just get on to certain programs. So we extended the hours of our help desk and then began to provide videos in English and Spanish to support and some Arabic where we could, because we have a very large Arabic speaking population, provide those supports for our families as well.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.
Any other questions from the members?
Hey, Chairman Bizarro, Mike Schlossberg here. If I could just make a quick comment.
Go ahead, Representative.
Thank you. And first of all, thank you all to the attendees. And Dr. Brown and Principal Bodner, it's wonderful to see you as always. And Taylor, thank you. If I'm going to take away anything from this, it's tragic that anyone in the middle of this pandemic should not be able to access Tiger King. But in all seriousness, thank you for that very apt metaphor. I don't have a question. I do have a comment, though. One of the things that I think plagues occasionally this caucus, or more often this Commonwealth, is we hear about the constant divide between our very large rural and urban, the very large rural and urban sectors of the state. And I really want to thank not only the sponsors of this hearing, but Representative Snyder in particular for bringing this to our attention, because there are a few things that truly can bind urban and rural Pennsylvania together, and that's broadband access, because we hear about this challenge on a regular basis. I'm an Allentown representative. These challenges are certainly nothing new. My wife teaches in the Allentown School District. I watched her struggle with her students. But more than anything else, I hope that we can all get the takeaway from this truly is that there is much less of a difference than rural and urban Pennsylvania than many of us may think there are. So again, that was it. I just wanted to make that point. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Any other questions from the members? Seeing none, Representative Snyder, do you want to welcome and introduce the next panel?
Yes, thank you, Mr. Chairman. And I think what Representative Schlossberg just said is accurate. I think we can see from this hearing, this is not an issue. This is not city versus rural. This is across the Commonwealth. It's my distinct honor now to introduce panel three, and the following folks will be presenting testimony. John Callahan with the Pennsylvania School Boards Association, Eric May, who is the superintendent of Brookville Area School District, Mrs. Amy Arcurio, superintendent of the Greater Johnstown School District, and Todd B. Beatty, superintendent of Northern Bedford County School District. So Mr. Chairman, we will have Mr. Callahan go first.
Hopefully everybody can hear me, but thank you very much for allowing us to testify today and present to this committee. And in a second, if I could be given the right to present, I'll be able to put some slides up for the committee to see. Just wanted to also outline for the committee our recent State of Education report that really took a deep dive into, here we go. I can actually present. Give me a second. That really took a deep dive into the pandemic and really the implications of it. So I'll really take you briefly through that report. Hopefully you're seeing my slides. The State of Education report really took a closer look. And when we're talking about what happened during the pandemic, 85% of our districts across the state were forced to change the instruction plans due to COVID-19. Obviously some did not, but really during our survey, which was done December and January, all in person was only 14%. Virtual was 39, basically 40%. And hybrid education was around 46%. As we look forward, there was lots of questions when we came to kind of what are the instructional challenges that students had experienced. And reduced in-person instruction time was really one of the biggest one, but adapting to the curriculum to virtual instruction is the second really biggest stress that we were really faced with. And that, I think you'll see from our presenters today, what that meant. And then third, even more, is the lack of internet, Wi-Fi, and other technologies kind of getting in the way of education. These are challenges. This survey, by the way, is everybody across the Commonwealth. So this isn't just, and I love that a few legislators have said, this isn't a rural, urban, suburban issue, it's an everybody issue in Pennsylvania. The other thing is the demand for devices and laptops. What do we most need? Laptops, Wi-Fi hotspots, tablets. These were all in high demand, and there's several stories where you ordered your equipment in March, but you didn't get it until January, or you got it in different drips and drabs along the way. So this was also a huge challenge, one that we're hopefully a little bit past, but one that will continue as we go on with kind of the new future of education. Many school districts had begun providing students with devices before the pandemic, which was good. So let's look at one-to-one electronic device programs across the state. Yes, for some students, a lot of our districts were really moving in that direction. No, 30%, and yes for all. I mean, only 22% before the pandemic. I would say a majority of our schools have moved to one-to-one exclusively, and really kind of, you know, have moved in this direction. But it's still an uphill battle, and something that's completely new for schools, as you can see, something we didn't do before the pandemic. And, you know, we're talking about it. Obviously, a lot of funds, a lot of taxpayer dollars went into this, and just wanted to talk about school district spending resources on the virtual learning options that we had to create. You know, when you're talking about an entire system that's built on that one-to-one in the classroom for the most part, changing overnight in March to really build up a virtual learning system. We had virtual schools before. We had online schools before from school districts, but the enrollment in those were not your entire school district. So when you move to a virtual platform and you're putting, 500% more, 400% more than the entire school into that platform, that's a lot of buildup and instruction and training you have to do with your school districts and your teachers. So briefly, I wanted to kind of set that background and then pass it back to, if I can actually stop presenting, that would be a good thing. Let me attempt to do that. I apologize. And I'd like to pass it over to our presenters, if possible. Was I successful or not in stopping the presentation?
Yes, yes, you were, Mr. Callahan.
Thank you, Representative Snyder. Appreciate it.
Thank you so much for that. That was very insightful. Next, we will have Eric May, Superintendent of Brookville.
Well, I want to thank the committee for this opportunity to testify. I understand that our purpose here is to focus on instructional technology and access to the internet, but I would be remiss if I didn't at least mention two great threats to public education in Pennsylvania. Special education costs have risen at a rate that far exceeds increases in funding. And in counties like ours, cyber charter costs have also skyrocketed. And we need the legislature to take a hard look at special ed funding and cyber charter tuition. The cyber charter problem takes me to today's topics. Here at Brookville, we had to develop remote learning capability, or we stood to lose even more students to cyber charters. In this increasingly competitive industry, public schools were already losing students to charter schools. And once the pandemic hit, cyber charters took full advantage, running billboards and full-page ads in the paper. And they were also able to take advantage of limitations imposed on traditional districts by the State Department of Education. So it's not just cyber charter funding reform that's needed. We really need the legislature to extend to public schools the same flexibility that's already been granted to cyber charters with regard to instructional time. If charters can count remote learning days as instructional days, which they do, Agora or Reach, they'll count 180 days of remote learning as instructional time. If they can do that, then public schools should be allowed to do the same without being limited to the 5 flexible instructional days that were designed for winter weather. My written testimony that I've submitted provide some detail about the great success we've had in Brookville in adopting remote learning capabilities quickly. We were a low-tech district when I got here not 2 years ago, and in a matter of months, we had Chromebooks for every student, we had a learning management system that allowed us to put our students in our courses online. And that remote learning capability allowed us to keep about 10% of our students on roster from home. You see, this district has been in person in the building every day this year. But we were able to do that in part because we gave families a choice. They could come into the building and get their education in the classroom, or they could stay home online on roster with our teachers in our courses. It was important to us that we be able to keep the kids on roster rather than assign them to a third party like Edgenuity or Odysseyware, or lose them to a cyber school like Reach or Agora, because we believe that students who stayed with us, even in this distance learning arrangement, were getting a better education than they would with a third-party vendor or cyber charter. A PDE in the spring, they pushed out like a million licenses to Odysseyware. But that's a kind of giving kids away to big business. And one of the things I think that the legislature needs to be mindful of going forward as we talk about spending this gobs of federal funds is that we don't want to spend all that money on devices, products, software that sends the money out of state. We should be careful that this money doesn't all go out of the Commonwealth. I've talked a little bit about the successes that we had here in terms of adopting remote learning capability quickly, but there are challenges remaining. We distributed hotspots to students whose families lack internet, but those devices only work where cell phone service is available. As Taylor pointed out, you can't use a hotspot in a dead zone. So some of our students still lack internet. I really want to point out that rural broadband isn't just a matter of instruction and education. It's also about economic opportunity and development. And all kinds of people have been allowed to or required to telecommute. My wife is a state employee, has to work from home during the pandemic. And increasingly, businesses are built on that model. We need broadband, rural broadband, in counties like ours, not just for the sake of our learners, but also for their parents' sake and to attract prospective employers. There's been a lot of talk about equity over the last year, and a lot of talk about equity in our industry and in the media is framed in terms of racial and gender equity. But the conversation about achieving a more just and fair society should not omit rural populations that lack access to cultural capital and educational economic opportunities. I'd like to close by pointing out that rural broadband is very much the purview of government. We did not wait for private companies and the free market to build our roads and highways, nor should we wait for Comcast to run the cable to the country. Thank you very much for this opportunity to testify on behalf of our students and staff and rural Pennsylvanians.
Thank you, Superintendent May. And may I just say, I agree with absolutely every word you just said. So thank you for your testimony. Thank you. Next, we have Mrs. Amy Arcurio, Superintendent of the Greater Johnstown School District.
Good afternoon. I would like to thank the Democratic policy folks of the House for giving me the opportunity to speak to you today and really share our story from Johnstown as to how we have had to navigate these very challenging times of the pandemic. For us, the district has felt the strains of being sorely underfunded for years. With a very small fund balance and most of our annual budget going to employee salaries and benefits, we have always had a very limited technology budget. When March 13th hit our school district, we unfortunately were unable to make that shift and pivot to virtual learning like so many of our neighboring school districts were able to do. We had one option for our students, and that was to provide them with paper and pencil enrichment and reinforcement packets. We were unable at the end of last school year to provide our students with any new learning at all. A spring telephone survey provided us with data that showed that 37% of our families did not have a device and about 42% of our families had no access to the internet. The first round of our ESSER funds was used to plan for the fall and purchase Chromebooks, as well as develop hotspots throughout our city so that our students could have access to new learning opportunities and we could move to virtual learning and remote hybrid learning options for our students. We ordered our Chromebooks just like everyone else did, and August came and left without the Chromebooks arriving. September was the same. We were now faced with the challenge of how do we get devices into our students' hands, and how do we take our very small amount of devices that we currently had in our school district and share them with our families. We were able to divide our entire district of 3,100 students into family groupings. At that time, we learned that about 1,700 families were part of the Greater Johnstown School District. We only had about 1,200 devices on hand that we could share with our families. It was really difficult to make the decision as to how certain families would have a device provided to them and certain families wouldn't. I'm fortunate enough to be in a community where superintendents work together and we all help each other, especially during tough times. It was during that time that a superintendent in a more affluent school district neighboring Greater Johnstown shared with me that he had about 500 Chromebooks that they were just putting out to scrap. And if we wanted to purchase those and refurbish those Chromebooks, we could do so for our children. We were unfortunately left to do just that. We purchased those additional 500 Chromebooks. We used our technology department to patchwork and piecemeal those Chromebooks together so that all 1,700 families in the Greater Johnstown School District at least had access to one device in their family to share with all of their children attending our schools. We also were very fortunate in a grassroots effort that a lot of our community partners were able to open guest internet sites for our families. We provided about 30 hotspots overall throughout the Johnstown community where families could travel to those hotspots to gain access to the internet. I thought this was really a great idea, and this was something that we were bringing to our families to help support virtual learning in a hybrid model, until I ran into one of our families. I talked to one of our moms, and she explained to me that she, to access the internet for her second grade student, had to take two buses across the city with three small children in tow to have access to the internet. That story really stuck with me, and I realized that the opportunity that we felt we were providing families just reinforced the barriers that our families face without having adequate internet capabilities. It was really unfortunate that we were asking our families to board a public transportation bus every day, take their children from their homes, and cross town on two bus transfers to be able to access the internet. And this was just to access asynchronous learning. This was not the synchronous learning that my fellow superintendents in more affluent school districts were able to offer their learners. Face-to-face, real-time learning, where teachers were able to see the looks on their children's faces and determine if a concept was being understood or not. In asynchronous learning, children do not have those opportunities. Lessons are viewed later, in the evening, maybe on the weekends, and then that work is being asked to be uploaded so that teachers can take a look at it and check it. We continue to wait during this time of hybrid learning for our Chromebooks to arrive. Finally, like Christmas, our Chromebooks arrived, and we were able then to supply all of our students with the one-to-one opportunity during this time that they had so patiently waited for. But we were still challenged with the lack of internet capabilities for our families. We had applied out to some national companies through grants and applications. And finally, in February, a national company provided us with 500 individual MiFis so that we could give those to our students who were lacking internet connection. We had to make a decision. Which of our students should receive those 500 MiFis that we received? I can tell you, as superintendent, I was really challenged to make that decision and make that determination on which one of my students should have access to the internet because of these free devices that we received. We made the decision that our most vulnerable learners, our special education students, 600 of them would have access to the 500 MiFi devices that we received. And we were able to utilize the additional ESSER monies to purchase additional MiFi hotspots, personal hotspots for those students. We know that relationships matter most for our students, and we also recognize that our students are most successful when they are in our schools with a caring adult, making decisions to help them navigate a very challenging world. We know that our children are best served when they are in our schools and they are with us. We know that the pandemic has placed major mental health concerns on our most fragile children who were already challenged to face this pandemic alone without the support of a caring teacher and adult that they had had access to prior to this time. We are now faced with the challenges of lost learning on top of the numerous challenges our students, most growing up in poverty, have already faced. Families in the Greater Johnstown School District are not only missing access to education at this time, but they are also missing access to physical health care, mental health care, and employment opportunities and connection to the world. We take a hard look at the social determinants of health in our community, and we rely heavily on the school's ability to be the hub, the access point for our families and our students to have their needs met beyond education. We take very seriously our responsibility to meet the needs of the whole child. We want to make sure that our students are always given the option to come into our schools and have real-time access to the teachers that they are given to support them. What we need is to ensure that our families are in a community where internet is looked at much like any other access that they are given to electricity or water or sewage. And internet cannot be looked at as a luxury, but as an opportunity for students to really bridge a community and a workforce that we are eager to support and to provide to our community. Thank you for your time.
Thank you, Mrs. Arcurio. Next, we have Todd Beatty, Superintendent of Northern Bedford County. Mr. Beatty?
Good morning. Can you hear me?
Yes, we can hear you.
Okay. Good morning, and thank you for inviting me to speak today. Again, I'm Todd Beatty, Superintendent of the Northern Bedford County School District. Northern Bedford is a rural, predominantly white district with 890 students, and we cover 113 square miles located in South Central PA. Our district has approximately 75% of non-cell phone coverage. So pretty much if you want to come to the district and you're going to use Google Maps, you probably should have a backup plan because you won't have service. 10 to 15% of our families do not have internet service. They're not able to get it. In addition to our traditional academics, we also have four career and tech programs, and we routinely score very well on the standardized testing, which includes our NOCTE testing as well. So that's just a little bit about the district. Last year, we've been one-to-one, sixth grade through 12th grade for several years now. Obviously, when Governor Wolf closed down the schools last year, we had to look for K-4 to fifth grade, and ultimately, we relied on our parents having some form of electronic devices for those that had internet service. Eventually, leading into this school year in late September, October, we were able to get the one-to-one for the elementary school. So what we felt were best practices, in the high school and middle school, we live streamed classes. However, we did not do it as we would traditionally. We basically set it up as about a 5 to 10 minute lesson live stream, and then there was opportunity for independent work or to ask questions. In the elementary school, we felt there was no way that kindergarten, first and second grade kids would be able to do that. And so the teachers did videos and posted them on a learning platform to allow the students to watch that when they could and do the work, hopefully with the help of either a babysitter, grandparent, or when their parents got home. The difficulties that we found were that we actually had students that eventually were getting tired of, they basically had technology fatigue. And some of our people that didn't have any internet, we were providing paper packets for them. And we began to have students that did have access start to request paper packets as well. They felt more comfortable actually with doing something in face-to-face paper than it was always through technology. And what we found though was that it was difficult for parents to work their day, come home and try to help their kids. Some of them have been out of school. Honestly, as a superintendent, if I had a child still in school and they wanted help with certain subjects, it would be difficult for me as well. We had families, multiple children in the family, and of course, the more people that are trying to use the internet, the bandwidth slows, the technology slows down. As I mentioned, lack of service. We've seen a lack of consistent routine, something that when the kids are in school that we have. I even talked with teachers, and they routinely told me that with their own children, they were having difficulty helping their own children. So it's just not a parent that works outside of education. These are actual educators that were having difficulty helping their own children with their schoolwork. Another factor is that I saw through technology is, you know, when you have the children in front of you, it's so easy to read the body language and to be able to pick up whether students are learning or grasping the concept. That becomes much more difficult when you're doing this through remote learning. And the last thing that we saw that was very negative and difficult to overcome was the social, emotional, and mental impacts that we felt. I know that we had kids that would get together outside of school back in the spring or whenever school was not in session. But it's interesting in talking with people that had multiple children, and one child was doing fine with everything and another child was not doing fine. So it just shows how much of an impact that had by not necessarily being in school. Two frustrations that I actually had that I was thinking about as I was hearing people talk was, quite frankly, PDE in the Department of Health was a frustration of mine. I have a clip here. I'll actually hold it up. I'm not sure if you'll be able to see it, but I cut it out. It's from the district administrator. And I keep that on my desk. I'm not sure why. But essentially, you see several plans there, and it's actually 26 plans. And the statement says, the staff really admire your determination to make the new school year work. And that's my frustration I had with PDE and Department of Health. Every time we were spending the hours to develop a plan, it seemed like there was a change. And then we had to go back to the drawing board. And then there was another change, and we had to go back to the drawing board. And that's what that cartoon picture illustrates. The second frustration that I'm really having now is with the ESSER money. I heard a representative speak about infrastructure. We actually, our middle school, high school is a 1963 building, and there's a lot of work that needs done on it. And it would be nice if they would just say, here is the money. We understand and we trust that you will use it the appropriate way. And then we can literally plan forward the next 3 to 5 years and develop a really quality building, an upgraded building. But the way they typically do it, it becomes very difficult to be able to plan out even more than you can't even plan a year out because you just don't know what's available. And finally, this year, quite frankly, cemented my belief that the absolute best place for children is in front of their teacher. Absolutely, without a doubt. I've seen it across the board. I understand this topic is about, the internet and availability, but I will, at the risk of saying perhaps I'm being old school here, this is the best place, children in front of their teachers. It allows for the consistency, it allows for the routine, and allows teachers to reach the children and be able to know if they understand the concepts or they don't, and remediate it very quickly. I believe it so much in the point that basically, although I've been approved for flexible instruction days, I have decided that I will not be using them unless it would prevent us having to extend the end of the school year. So thank you again for inviting me to speak to you today.
Thank you. And questions from the members? All right. Thank you all for your testimony. We appreciate you taking time to be with us today. Next, Representative Cephas will introduce the next panel.
Great. Fantastic. Thanks, Chairman. So for our final panel, we will have Joseph Schlimbaum, hopefully I pronounced that correctly, who is the attorney advisor at the Federal Communications Commission. We will also have Glenn Miller, Deputy Secretary and Commissioner for Libraries for the Pennsylvania Department of Education, and Judd Pittman, who is the Special Consultant to the Secretary of Education for STEM for the Pennsylvania Department of Education. So I am going to turn it over to Mr. Schlimbaum.
Hi there. Good afternoon, everyone. Thank you for having me. My name is Joe Schlingbaum. I'm an attorney advisor with the Federal Communications Commission. And I'm going to talk today about two commission programs to bring broadband to schools, libraries, and our nation's students. I'm going to share some slides while I do this. Okay. So the two programs I'm going to discuss are the E-Rate program and the Emergency Connectivity Fund. We'll cover a bit on both. So the E-Rate program was authorized by the Telecommunications Act of 1996, and the goal is to bring next generation communications technology to our nation's schools and libraries. It broadly supports two categories of service. Schools can get funding for monthly recurring service, such as their monthly internet charges, as well as what we call category two services, which are internal connections to bring the internet to the classroom. So think funding for Wi-Fi networks, routers, things like that. It's about a $4 billion a year cap. It doesn't always authorize that much. Most public, charter, and some other not-for-profit schools are eligible, as are many libraries. We also see applications from consortia comprised of both eligible schools and libraries. The program works on a discount rate basis. So we look at the percent of students in a school district that are eligible for free and reduced lunch, and we put this matrix together that I have displayed. And so, for example, a school that has a $100 a month charge that's eligible for a 90% discount, the school would pay 10 of those dollars, and the program would pay the remaining 90, and the scale works from there. One of the cornerstones of the program is competitive bidding. So all applicants, with some very limited exceptions, are required to seek competitive bids for all products and services that they'd like to procure. Once they've identified service providers through competitive bidding, they apply to the administrator for the program, the Universal Service Administrative Company, for funding, and they will receive a funding commitment, which is the maximum amount of money that the school is eligible to spend in that funding year for services or equipment. They will actually receive the money from USAC, rather from the US Treasury, upon receiving service and providing invoices to request reimbursement for services received. Most recurring services have to be delivered during the applicable funding year, which runs from July 30th July 1st to June 30th of the following year. The non-recurring services, the equipment installations, have a slightly longer time frame and can be extended owing to some of the differences there. During the coronavirus pandemic, we've done a few things to make the E-Rate program able to adapt to the needs of the community. We'll talk about the Emergency Connectivity Fund in a moment. We finished a comment cycle just this year seeking comments on ways the E-Rate program can be used to support remote learning. We also opened an additional filing window last fall that gave school districts the ability to seek additional funding mainly to cover their bandwidth needs. And we issued a handful of waivers. We extended some deadlines, otherwise clarified our rules to try to make the program as responsive as it could be in a limited way to the coronavirus pandemic. In this slide here, we have some resources on both the FCC's website and on USAC's webpage. So I'll talk a bit now about the Emergency Connectivity Fund, which I think some earlier panelists had discussed, maybe during the first panel. So this is approximately a $7 billion fund that was authorized in the American Rescue Plan. And the commission does have until May the 10th to adopt rules to govern the distribution of this funding. It's mainly designed to support remote learning. And I can pull up this next slide. So the same general categories of applicants are eligible, schools and libraries. This fund, unlike the E-Rate fund, can directly support hotspots, modems, connected devices like laptops and tablets, which the E-Rate fund generally does not support. And it can also be used for broadband services. It doesn't work on the discount rate basis. The statute contemplates that 100% of the cost will be reimbursable so long as they are reasonable and funding is available. And the program, the statute contemplates the program could be retroactive to the date when the Secretary of Health and Human Services declared a public health emergency. And we are working with USAC to administer this fund like the E-Rate fund. We're right in the middle of a notice and comment cycle. We issued a public notice in the middle of this month seeking comment on how we should adopt rules to administer the Emergency Connectivity Fund. Initial comments are due on Monday, April 5th, and there's an opportunity for reply comments on April 23rd. And we encourage all stakeholders to file comments. You can find the docket by following the link to this public notice, or you can find it on our webpage. To submit your comments, because we think this is an important initiative, and we're looking to put the rules together for it. So those are the slides that I have for today. And again, I thank you all for the opportunity to share this information with you, and I'll be available for questions at the end of this panel. Thank you.
Thank you. So now we're going to have Glenn Miller.
Thank you, Representative Cephas, and thank you, Chairman Bizarro, and members of the Democratic Policy Committee. I very much appreciate this opportunity to discuss the digital divide here, representing the Department of Education, along with my colleague, Judge Pittman, who you'll also hear from. I've been with the department since 2015 as a Deputy Secretary for Libraries. We oversee the state and federal government's investment in library services, and we collaborate with our colleagues in the pre-K, K-12, and post-secondary education worlds on a variety of learner-focused initiatives. So pleased to be here with Judge Pittman, who also works in this space, especially in the STEM space. I know we're a little bit pressed for time, so I'm gonna try to be brief. I wanna just focus on a couple points of where things stand currently in terms of the digital divide, which we know is a chronic problem and one that has been laid bare during this pandemic. One in four students nationally are unable to access school online. We know that even though the number of disconnected households fell dramatically during the 2010 decade, there are still too many households, far too many households that have disconnected. But we also know that students in low-income households are considerably more at risk, and they are far more likely to not be engaged in remote learning as the students are from their higher income peers. So we know that is a problem that continues to be a serious one that we need to address collectively here in Pennsylvania. Closing this digital divide is not going to be cheap. We know it's a multi-billion dollar investment nationally, and it is here in Pennsylvania as well. And we know that it's important to do, though, because we know that students' outcomes, their academic achievement, is impacted if they don't have the kind of access that we all want them to have. Here in Pennsylvania, we have more than 900,000 households that lack an internet connection. And the Center for Rural Pennsylvania reinforced that number. That was an FCC number, and the Center for Rural Pennsylvania came up with a similar number. It's also true that that the number of disconnected households is more likely to be higher in urban counties. The number, the percentage of disconnected households is higher in rural areas. So I just want to sort of wrap this piece of it up by noting that that this issue consists of several key elements. Of course, we know that the availability of an internet connection for hundreds of thousands of households is not there, and that's a problem, clearly. So availability is a problem for us. We also know that even if you're connected, sometimes the speed and reliability of that service impacts the students' learning and the household's connection, broadly speaking, for all activities. And we heard that earlier in the session. We also need to be cognizant of the fact that affordability is very much an issue for many Pennsylvanians. So even if you have the option to connect, your ability to connect to it financially is an obstacle for many families. And we also know that accessibility, and that is if you can have an internet connection, but if you don't have appropriate and adequate devices in your household, that adds another dimension to the problem. I know my colleague, Mr. Pittman, will want to talk a little bit more about some of the specifics that we've addressed at the department, but I also want to just take a moment at this point to for a special shout out and thanks to Representative Snyder for her work on broadband issues. I had the honor of representing the department at the Joint State Government Commission during their work, which is ongoing, on looking at broadband in Pennsylvania for unserved and underserved areas of Pennsylvania. Those are rural areas as well as urban areas. That work continues, and Representative Snyder has been a leader in that. So, Representative Cephas, thank you for your leadership on workforce issues and a whole range of other issues that that impact education. And with that, I'll turn it back to you.
Thank you, Mr. Miller. Last but not least is Mr. Pittman, who again is the special consultant to the Secretary of Education for STEM. Mr. Pittman.
Thank you, Representative Cephas, and thank you, committee members, for giving the department an opportunity to be part of the conversation today and really share some bright spots that have resulted from the conditions brought on by the COVID-19 pandemic. The pandemic has magnified and intensified the characteristics of the education system that have not been equitably serving communities and learners across Pennsylvania. The lack of high-quality broadband access in Pennsylvania and device access in our communities is just one example of those factors that have been intensified. Another example was the struggle that our systems have had to meet the needs of English language learners, students with disabilities, and other vulnerable populations like students experiencing homelessness as a result of the COVID-19 school building shutdown. But, you know, despite these challenges, as many of the educational leaders shared today during the hearing, our educators, our caregivers, our learners, our administrators across communities and across our educational systems, from early childhood to post-secondary, rose to the challenge of including all communities and all learners in distance education. And one thing that we've learned from all of our partners here at the department is that we've widened that aperture of possibility for learners by designing first for the most vulnerable and not serving the most vulnerable as an afterthought when we think about program and policy solutions. And some innovations that we wanted to highlight and have been ignited across our systems as a result of the COVID-19 pandemic. One is this idea of design and how we design services and professional learning, making sure that they're universally designed, thinking about the walkway to a library. There's a ramp and there's steps. And you can take the ramp or you can take the steps, but whether you're in a wheelchair or you may have mobility issues, you're going to be able to get in that front door. And that's the kind of services that we want to provide. And we want to make sure that we're providing an asset-based approach and looking at learners' and educators' lived experiences, assets, as we move forward during this journey. And we've also been able to see how schools collectively work with their community partners to meet the needs and remove barriers for families, and often taking a collective impact approach. And there were several examples brought forth today by our partners that have shared, but there's a couple that resonate in my mind as we've learned from communities across Pennsylvania. One is Butler Area School District, and when the pandemic hit, their superintendent was able to work together with their county commissioners, with their local hospital, with their post-secondary partners to create a sound strategy for delivering not only learning product, but also food distribution to families across their particular school district. Or I think about Harrisburg City School District and the collaboration between city government and the mayor's office to deliver educators on the government access channel to learners in their homes as our youngest learners so desperately wanted to see their educators that they missed. And as the superintendent from Northern Bedford shared, there's something very special about the connection our learners have with our educators, and it's so valuable to their not only their academic growth, but their social and emotional growth. We've also had innovations with our intermediate units and our patent systems on how we deliver high-quality professional learning to our educators and administrators. Our teams have been able to adjust, providing smaller chunks of professional learning in a synchronous and an asynchronous fashion at different times of the day, targeted on skill development and really pressing for application. A couple of those examples would be a collaboration out in the western part of the Commonwealth between roughly about 7 intermediate units, Remake Learning Network, and some other community partners to deliver what they called the On-Ramp Professional Learning Series to get educators small chunks of professional learning to best prepare them for delivering distance education. We also launched at the department, we're launching what we call the Accelerated Learning Initiative, which is going to provide supports for administrators and educators and caregivers, both academic, social, emotional, and trauma-informed supports. And then in a world that's near and dear to me, in that STEM space, we were able to provide a program we called CSNPA Build Fly Code, which piloted with 30 communities and 30 educators, STEM education in a distance environment, both synchronously and asynchronously, leveraging drones and getting educators the skills necessary to deliver that to their students. In that professional learning space, in the last quarter alone, our IU partners have delivered over 8,000 hours of professional learning to our school communities in that STEM and CS space and beyond. Some of the technologies in the toolbox for closing the digital divide, the department has been exploring all kinds of different spaces for supporting our communities, caregivers, and learners that don't have high-quality internet access. And as Mr. Miller shared, there's over hundreds of thousands of Pennsylvanians that don't have that service. And so we've piloted microcontrollers, so these like mini computers to act as digital content learning hubs for those without internet. We distributed 500 of them in a pilot phase across communities in Pennsylvania with our partners in Intermediate Unit 11 and partnering with Forbes Road Area School District. They went door to door to deliver these units to families and worked with them to make sure that in the remote setting, even without internet access, learners had high quality digital content that was on par with their partners that did. We also worked on a statewide collaborative with PBS, our intermediate units and public libraries, to deliver 5 hours a day of standards aligned programming content via the television in tandem with grab and go kits. And in the springtime alone, we distributed 10,000 of those kits. And in the last quarter, over 525 hours of standards aligned programming targeted to our earliest learners, but with resources up through 12th grade. As part of Governor Wolf's GEARS investment, PDE launched what we called the Connecting to Learning Initiative, which was a statewide collaboration with Pennsylvania PBS, our libraries, our intermediate units. And it's to leverage existing TV signal to data cast for students digital content for those that don't have internet access. So it's an opportunity to get everything that we send via the internet using the TV signal to students in their homes, the digital content that they need to be successful. We currently have approximately 30 sites that we're working with to pilot this technology across early childhood, K-12, adjudicated youth programs, and workforce. And a couple of those highlighted pilot sites were working with George Hill Prison in Delaware County to look at data casting and delivering digital content for adjudicated youth programs. We're working with our partners in Intermediate Unit 1 and 4 school districts, Avella Area, Central Green, McGuffey, Brownsville, to provide data casting strategies for their communities. And finally, Somerset County Library, they've been leading the way on this collective impact model, providing grab-and-go kits, online instruction, and delivering hotspots to the Somerset community. Each and every one of our 2 million learners in Pennsylvania over this COVID-19 pandemic has experienced social and emotional trauma over the last year, just like us, just like adults. Each of the 2 million learners deals with anxieties, pressure, stress, and the excitement of returning back to school for in-person learning. And each of our learners has accumulated experience over the last year that can be viewed as an asset to that future learning. As we consider the coming weeks and months ahead, it will be critical that collectively as decision makers, we take the responsibility of not just going back to normal, but instead taking full advantage of the funding allotted by opportunities like the American Rescue Plan and the opportunity afforded by the pandemic to restart, reimagine our education systems, to dismantle the systemic racism and classism that has been a barrier to far too many of our learners. To help make sure we springboard forward from the pandemic, the Pennsylvania Department of Education is committed to bringing stakeholders closer to the center of the program and policy decisions. And PDE is collaborating with some of our partners out west, Remake Learning Network, Knowledge Works, and Allegheny Intermediate Unit 3, for a series of listening sessions. And we launched a statewide survey for administrators, educators, caregivers, out-of-school time partners, early childhood providers, and most importantly, learners, to spotlight those innovations that are working, those things that we want to keep, those things that we want to invest in, and to uncover those that are not, so that we can collectively make mindful investments to create more inclusive learning environments for all of our scholars. I want to thank the policy committee and all of our folks that were testifying today for this opportunity. And I'm going to turn the floor back over to Representative Cephas.
Thank you so much for your testimony. And with that, I will turn it over to Chairman Bizarro.
Thank you. Thank you all for your testimony. Any questions from the members?
I have a quick question. So given your roles that you play at the Department of Education as well on the federal level, how do you foresee with the added pressures to your systems, how do you see moving forward that we utilize federal dollars that are coming down to Pennsylvania to help address the digital divide in our areas? Because as you can imagine, not only were parents going to local school buildings to catch their Wi-Fi towers, but then libraries were being used in the same way. So how do you feel like your infrastructure needs can help address the challenges that we're having?
It's a great question, Representative Cephas. One of the great challenges, I think, is to make sure that we invest these federal dollars in the wisest possible way. I think we start the conversation with an understanding that this problem of the digital divide and lack of access is a huge problem, and not one that the Department of Education alone will be able to solve. But within the space where we have control, as Judd indicated, one of our top of our list of priorities is to make sure that the investments we make, whether it's technology, training, the whole nine yards, it's important that we begin with an acknowledgement that we have a system that is inequitable, and that we need to begin to address that. And we're going to have an opportunity, perhaps a once-in-a-generation opportunity with these federal dollars, to make sure that we do that right. I have to say that our experience over the last year is one that has taught us a lot of lessons, and surely we've made mistakes, as everyone has in this pandemic. But it also is true that we're better positioned now to understand the nature of what it is we need to do. And maybe Judd wants to add on to that.
But I think that was well said. The thing that I would add is just making sure that we take advantage of the data elements and the evidence that we have. And all of our school district partners shared some of those numbers around lack of connectivity or lack of devices, but that we listen to our communities and we do listen to our students. They've been the consumers of this for the last 12 months, and we make sure to continue to give them what they need for success. But we also remove those things that have been barriers. And I believe it was Dr. May had shared that this isn't just an education problem. This is about economic vitality and economic opportunity. And we want all of our learners, those 2 million learners, to have those economic opportunities for the future. And for us to be competitive, we need to put all the tools on the table and use every tool in our tool belt to get to close that digital divide and that knowledge gap that results from it.
Thank you for that, because, as you can imagine, it's not just accessing education during a regular school day, but when you think of summer jobs that are coming up for young people and a lot of that being virtual as well, it's just, we really have to figure out how do we improve our infrastructure, year round for students. So I appreciate that you're thinking forward and ensuring that libraries are incorporated in whatever plan that we roll out. So thank you.
I'm going to ask a question, Mr. Pittman, or whoever wants to jump in here. How is digital access affecting STEM learning in our students?
I think the STEM learning space, it's really critical that you know, one of the things that I've had the pleasure of being as part of that journey. And anyway, when we would visit schools or we talk to learners, the thing that really gets them excited is often that STEM space or the learning that gets to take root, the student agency that happens as a result of. And so we got to make sure that as we move forward, we don't lose sight of that, that we continue to provide those opportunities, whether it's during the traditional school day, whether we leverage our out-of-school time providers, whether we leverage our cultural institutions. But so often, those are the spaces that students really get excited about and look forward to. So we can't squeeze that curiosity and that excitement away. We got to continue to provide those resources. And one thing that we've saw is, you know, educators have been really creative in how they deliver those experiences. Sometimes it's a synchronous online experience or asynchronous experience that they're doing some of the work. They send a kid home. They get to do some of that hands-on learning. With the drones experience, we were able to get the drones in the hands of educators, provide the professional development, and then they were able to find ways, whether in a social distance environment outside or just through protocol of making sure that the devices were cleaned and used properly, getting them into the hands of students. I think we're only limited by our creativity in that space, and there is so much opportunity that we continue to move forward, whether it's traditional STEM learning, computer science learning. You know, we haven't seen a drawdown in the interest in the professional learning around that, or the interest in initiatives like the governor's PA Smart initiative. You know, there's still a lot of opportunity, and ultimately the workforce, that's the workforce need. That's where our economy is growing, and we need to make sure that we're continuing to deliver that to kids.
Excellent. Any other questions from the members? Listen, I want to thank everyone who participated today and those who offered written and oral testimony today. I think this is a very important topic. We have a lot of members who are working very hard on here and for this, and a special thanks to all of our co-hosts today who came together and put this hearing together for the members. With that in mind, I'm going to ask one more round. Is there any questions, final questions? Thank you all, and the meeting is adjourned.